Welcome to Ask Dr. Doreen. I want to give a quick shout out to the folks who are saying hi to us on Facebook Live. Christina Adams, hello. And Millie Hensley, hello.
We're our favorites.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. But we are here right now with Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh, who I love and adore.
Thank you. So nice to be back with you guys. It's lovely to have you here today.
Yeah, we love being here because I learned so much.
This is a fun session with you.
Yeah, it's such a great experience to be able to hear you give feedback on a lot of these important questions
Thank
that families
much.
Have at home.
I'll start by saying that the 2% is 1 in 45.
Okay.
Which is the correct number according to Autism Speaks right now.
Is it really?
1 in 45.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah. Shocking.
So I want to say for anybody who has not watched the show before, because we get new viewers every day, Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh is a true expert in the field of autism. She's been working in this field for more than 30 years. I know that you look at her and think that isn't possible, but it's true. There's a painting aging underneath her bed somewhere. But yes, she's been working in this field for more than 30 years, has worked with all kinds of individuals on the spectrum, from very young babies up through senior citizens. I believe that there is no better expert in the world in this field, and it's thrilling that she's able to be with us an hour a week and to answer your questions in real time. And we do like to remind everybody, though, at the start of the show that there is no expert in this forum that can give individual specific advice. It would be a disservice to the individuals on the spectrum to even intimate that she could get enough information to give individual specific advice, but we get to ask her questions and find out what she knows, because it's mind-blowing always to hear what you know. Today will be fun because
the three of us, I'm sure we'll have lots of different points of view on things.
Do you want to jump right into a question? I do want to jump in with a question that we had come in
on our Facebook page. Hi, Shannon and Dr. Doreen. My son is 3 years and a month. He started school pre-autism class on October 28th, 2016. He's verbal. Functional communication is low, very good at labeling things. His school is half day for 2 days and full day for 3 days. He goes for school at 8:30 and returns at 5 p.m.
That must be the full days, I would imagine.
That sounds like a full day.
Yeah, sure. That's a really full day.
The issue is he's not eating or drinking at all in school since December 8th. In the beginning, he was eating more or less. After a few weeks, he stopped. Hmm. 2 days prior to not eating, his teacher reported that he cried in the school for no apparent reason. That day, he was showing more affection when he was at home. He is eating well at home as he used to. He takes food by himself for one or two times initially. Then he has to be fed. I'm putting lunch and snacks that he is more likely to eat without prompting. His teacher says they are trying different strategies to feed and that he's happy most of the time except during mealtime and diaper changing. She went on to write to us a little bit later on that she says, during the weekend, I want to feed him to kind of recoup the loss during the week, but I also want him to feed on his own so that it's easier for him during school's lunchtime. So, Dr. Granpeesheh, what do you think?
So I have a lot of different feelings about this. You know, the world is never ideal, but if it was, and if this parent has the ability, I would not introduce the child to school until they had the ability to feed themselves independently and also did not require diaper changing. Mm. So what I would do is, given that he's only 3 years old, I would actually do a home program right now where I would focus on teaching the child how to feed himself completely a meal and also toilet train him. Now, of course, as I said, the world is not perfect, so we are where we are, and I assume the parent has no other option but to have the child in school, which basically means that, and 3 is too young to even call for an IEP. You could potentially get an IEP in place, but we're talking about preschool. So there's no obligation here to complete any form of IEP because it's preschool. I'm assuming it's going to be a private type of setting. Could be a public preschool because it's a pre-autism class, which I've never heard before, by the way, so I'm not sure what that is.
Yeah.
But I assume it's a full social special education program. So what you need to do is you need to get some resources in. You need to talk with the special ed teacher and the resource specialist for the school and say that you need two plans. One plan for him to learn how to feed himself completely, immediately, and the other plan for potty training. He's past the age of potty training, and that the sooner you do this, the better. Now, I would, having said that, you've gotten him almost there. Like, he has two steps, and then you haven't just finished the process. So it's not going to be hard for him. But something possibly happened on a day sometime in December, and I'm not sure what could have happened. See, our kids, it's very hard to see the world from their perspective because they have very different sensory abilities. So anything could have scared him. I mean, we don't necessarily want to jump to the fact that it could have been like somebody being mean to him or a bully or a teacher or something like that. It could just be something as simple as a sound scared him.
So interesting you bring that up, yeah. Doreen, because Wyatt, in preschool,
yeah.
they brought fire engines to the
there
preschool.
You go.
And that has set him up for a life of
being
of. Freaked out by sirens.
See, it's just such basic stuff and we never know it.
Right, we don't.
And so it's I'm almost certain, though, that if it was a sudden transition like that, where he was eating fine and then suddenly he stopped, that and he's uncomfortable and unhappy during mealtime, something happened.
Yeah.
So, and we don't want to point fingers at anyone, but the point is that needs to be fixed. So it is incredibly important for him to have someone with him who is able to kind of look at his reactions, figure out what is causing the fear. I mean, I had a child who was terrified of the buzzer, which happens in between classes. I mean, and that just destroyed his whole school experience, whereas when we got the school to shut off the buzzer, everything was fine. So it's kind of like we really need to figure out what it was, and that's incredibly important for him. I do personally think that being in school from 8:30 to 5 is an incredibly long period of time for a 3-year-old, even if it's only 2 days. I'll be very honest and say that I don't think this is his current schedule is the best use of his time. If you have any ability whatsoever to try to actually replace all of this with a center-based ABA program, I would highly recommend it. He's only 3. You don't really have to put him in a academic program until 5. So in most states, I don't know where you are. But you really should consider doing that. He will learn a massive amount more if he has one-to-one instruction using ABA.
Can we just take a second to, because I had a lot of people ask me over the break that I ran into, because we were talking about center-based and how the studies are in and we're seeing how much more effective
it is
than the old home-based model.
Yeah, I mean, and to be honest, Shannon, I just looked at the ratio and we have 61% of our hours currently being provided in center-based because so many parents have transitioned to center-based.
I just transitioned 2 days a week to center-based for Wyatt.
And it's nice for them. The kids enjoy it. It's a lot of fun for them and they have a lot back-to-back. There's no cancellations. You know, there's a lot of benefits to
and
it.
And the peer support.
They have
so, especially
there,
for teens, why it's 15
supervisors
now.
Are there. Yeah, there's a lot of benefit to it.
But here's the question that people are asking, because they've heard you say on the show, when you have a 3-year-old, that school isn't the first choice.
Right.
And so they're asking, what's the difference between going to a preschool and going to a center base?
Oh.
And I think that's a great question.
Great question.
But maybe we
great
can take
question.
A minute to talk about what the difference
Absolutely.
Is.
Absolutely. So in a preschool program, obviously you have anywhere, you know, 20 other kids, and you have a teacher and possibly an aide, maybe 2 aides. And they are managing the kids, and they're based on a schedule, so that usually preschools will start with circle time, and then they'll do calendar, and then they'll do some singing, and then they'll do stations, like arts and crafts, or whatever it is, the stations, and the kids will rotate that way. And in between, obviously, they have lunch and recess and so on. In our program, in the center-based programs, it's all one-to-one, so the child comes in, doesn't matter what age or level of functioning, they have a one-to-one program. So it's an ABA program that has been written for them, just as if they were receiving it at home, except they're receiving it in the center. What is incorporated into the program is they will, if we have other children who are available, who are same level of functioning or, you know, similar level of functioning, we will then have some group activity for the child. So they do develop more play skills. They do have also, they rotate to various other things like going to the gym and so on, which is beneficial for some of the kids. But the entire day is set up one-to-one. So they will have a therapist or various therapists who are with the child at all times, focusing on specifically what the child needs. Definitely not going to be academic, which is in preschools, you're usually heading into academic. For us, age three is the critical age. So depending on the child's needs, I mean, some of the kids are extremely high functioning, others have no skills when they come in, but whatever their needs are, we focus mainly on executive functioning skills, the development of some language, a lot of social skills, and then getting rid of those symptoms of autism, basically. So teaching the child to communicate instead of tantrum, teaching the child to interact appropriately, give eye contact, have appropriate social behavior, all of that sort of stuff.
But these skills are so important because a child really can't access the academic skills until they have some of these skills mastered.
Absolutely. Is that correct? And that's I mean, there's two ways to look at academic for me. One is, for sure, I mean, you're looking at things like, you know, math and reading and writing and all that sort of stuff, and those things become important for some children at some age. There's no question you're not going to be able to, you know, read and summarize or talk about what you just read if you don't have language or if you don't have the ability to break apart a sentence even. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, these are much, much more simpler, easier tasks that build up to more complicated tasks. And then the second part of it is, you know, not all children benefit from academic. I mean, in the country we have this, the law still is that, hey, even if you go to special ed, you're going to be studying academics. And the truth is, it's not appropriate. For some kids past a certain level, the focus of education, their time, should not be spent doing math. They will never benefit from doing math or geography or whatever it is. They will benefit from things that, unfortunately, we don't spend time on. Yeah. You know, we should be spending the entire day for our kids who have more severe aspects of autism on things like communicating, mm-hmm. using an AUG device, you know, expressing themselves, being able to tell their parents when something's wrong. There's so much stuff that's more important than things like academics. So it's really important that the programs that, and unfortunately, most of the time we have to adhere to these academic regulations, but if we don't, in cases where we don't, we really modify the program to meet the child's needs, and it's a lot better.
I know for us, when Jen was diagnosed at 2.5, we started ABA at 3, we had a bit of a battle with the school district because they wanted him to go to a preschool program at 3 and be there all day long, what this parent is describing here, and we wanted to do an ABA program. And at that time, it was at home.
Right.
We fought, and we, you know, weren't going to budge. That just wasn't going to happen. And so he stayed home and had his intensive ABA program at home, and that year made all the difference.
Yeah,
yeah. And we, because we got a later diagnosis, Wyatt was in a preschool program for autism.
Right.
And
that's
starting
right.
at age 3.
That's right.
And I can say from experience, if I had been able to have him in an ABA-based program, I would have far preferred that.
Yes.
And that I felt that those years from 3 to 4.5 when he first started getting
critical
ABA
years.
Were not particularly as useful because he was with a lot of kids.
Right. Yesterday,
one teacher to a lot of kids.
Absolutely. And I went back this year. One of the things I'm doing in quarter one for our staff, and we have about 300 supervisors now, so I'm kind of going back and reviewing all the very important literature, which I might do for your show as well, Shannon.
It's love like, that.
Yeah. So there's a lot of, you know, I've selected my favorite 20 articles in mm-hmm. our field, and I'm mm-hmm. Summarizing all of them and kind of working on putting them in PowerPoint so that I can use that to train all of our supervisors again. I mean, this is stuff we all know, but going back to the detail is
right.
really important.
Right.
And some of the stuff I was summarizing yesterday just made me realize that, you know, there is a reason that we start so early. I mean, first of all, we don't even have really accurate screening or diagnostic procedures earlier than age 2. So it's very hard to diagnose a child accurately prior to age 2. Once you get the diagnosis, I mean, there are symptoms occurring prior to age 2, red flag symptoms, but not things that you would necessarily call autism, mm-hmm. right? I mean, the other day somebody wrote to me and said, the child lines up objects all the time. And I thought to myself, if that's the only thing, I don't know if I would be that concerned right now because the child is two and all mm-hmm. that sort of stuff. But then as I pursued and asked questions, the parent told me, no, they also don't necessarily do joint attention activities. Mm-hmm. And, you know, joint attention, the lack of joint attention is the number one red flag for autism. Mm. It occurs around one or two. Mm. And these are not things that most of the time, when they come to me, the first thing they have seen is language not developing at three or two and a half, three. Mm-hmm. That's what most people see. That's a year later than the first sign. The first sign is usually gaze, like when I look at you and then I track and see you're looking at the TV, mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. is something that's absent in our kids. That's joint attention. And those types of signs are so important to pay attention to because both of you know how difficult it is to get a good program in place, right? You have to find the right person, get into their program, find the funding for it, all that. Mm-hmm. And you're in California.
Right.
Some
right.
people have a budget.
Yeah.
Right.
So once you get, if you give yourself a year to get that program in place and the funding and so on, or even 6 months,
right.
then you really want to start at two so you're kind of ready to go around mm-hmm. two and a half, three. Because we published a bunch of stuff in pediatrics a year ago, 2 years ago, and it was all summary of all the reports that exist out there that are very solid research in our field. And all of these are telling us that what happens with the brain is that you are developing new growth around two to three and a half. That's mm-hmm. exactly the period of time. It's mm-hmm. like, three becomes a really vital period. Three to four is where the brain starts to develop new dendrites, new growth, synapse growth. Everything is growing in the brain. And after four, five, all of the stuff that wasn't used just dies. Literally in your brain, all the dendrites and axons, all the nerve fibers that aren't being used just die off. And only the ones that are being used, mm. like repetitive behavior,
right.
you know,
right.
those are the ones that actually remain. Ah. And that period of time, three to four and a half, five, when you said, is the most important period of time for developing the right neural networks. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think it's just so important to get in as early as possible.
Yeah, for sure. So what are the action items for this mom again? It would be to try to get a good ABA program going.
Get a good ABA program if you can. If you can't, then you need to talk to your school and try to get some resources in, because definitely what's happening here is not good. They need to figure out what happened and try to help the child eat better.
And what about the fact on the weekend she's trying to recoup the loss and feed him more on the weekends?
I think, and Shannon, tell me what you think, but my understanding is she's trying to just make sure he gets enough calories because he's
nutrients.
Not eating all day.
Yeah.
I would be a little concerned about any 3-year-old who's not eating from 8 a.m. or 8:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. I mean, I'm not just worried about his calorie intake. I'm worried about his dehydration and various other things.
And the fact that as you said, and I don't mean to interrupt you, Dr. Granpeesheh, but as you said, that it's so, that there clearly was an event.
Something happened.
And it's got to go back to that. And a lot of times I think we get a little stymied as parents that we're like, is it me? It seems like something's going on. Do I do something? Do I focus on this? Which part of it do I focus on? And I think it's undeniable that something happened and that needs to be dealt with.
I agree.
However you can deal with it.
I agree. I would listen to your inner voice here. I would not just ignore it. I would definitely get someone in there, do observations, figure out what's going on. I would not continue to just put him in that placement.
Absolutely. If there's any way you can avoid it. And I want to track back for just a second for all of us that have children that are over the age of five mm-hmm. that heard what you said and a little part of us went,
yeah.
Right? But I want to make sure that everybody knows that there's always progress available for everyone.
Right.
Even though
definitely.
You lose some ground.
Yeah, definitely.
And there are opportunities that are missed,
And let's just be clear, you may not lose ground. So like, if you are, let's say, between 3 and 5, mm-hmm. using a ton of repetitive language, mm-hmm. you're going to still be developing neural networks in the language area of the brain.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's just not the appropriate language, but you are developing Wernicke's area.
Right.
Okay, you might be using it inappropriately, but you're not losing anything. We just then can shape it.
Right.
We don't want to panic. All we really want to say is that, generally speaking, so far, research shows that the earlier you start, we all know this, mm-hmm. the better it is. And also the second thing that I was summarizing yesterday, which is worth repeating, I think, is that almost all science that in any way documents children who have done well, we call them the best outcome children. So these are children who have either recovered or have close to, have improved significantly or functional and so on. In almost all of those documented cases, the parents were heavily involved
mm-hmm.
in the program.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to say that I know that it's very difficult for all of us to do more than we do. We all are just like overtaxed as it is. But involvement doesn't necessarily mean time. It sometimes also just means knowing what's going on.
Right. Knowing what your program is.
Exactly.
Yeah, I am one of those cases. Wyatt started his ABA program at 4 3/4.
Right.
But what I want to tell parents out there is I can't imagine had he not gotten a solid ABA program at 4 3/4.
Right.
He may not have gotten it at 3.
Right.
But the amount, I mean, is it true, Dr. Granpeesheh, that some of our kids even will continue to regress if they don't get a program?
Oh, of course.
Right.
Absolutely.
That's what I see would have happened.
Absolutely. And sometimes you see, sometimes I work with, my favorite age range is the adolescents.
Right,
and
right.
Like when you're talking about probably about 15, I don't know, maybe even 12
right,
to
right.
18 or
right,
20.
Right.
That age range, when you see the kids, you're very lucky, like Wyatt as an example is a very sweet character.
Yes.
All he really wants is for everybody to leave him alone so he can do his OCD stuff,
right,
you know.
Right.
But he's a sweet character and he's not a frustrated kid. You've
right.
done such a good job and everybody has understood him so that his world has been fair. What I see a lot of times with kids who get zero intervention,
mm-hmm.
they can't communicate and no one in their world, in their environment, understands them.
Right.
So they just become hugely frustrated.
Yes.
And then when they're 17, 18 and so on, they're aggressive. And
right.
once you're big and aggressive, all anyone can do is put you in a hold, put you in a,
mm-hmm.
like keep themselves
mm-hmm.
safe.
Mm-hmm.
So then the environment just becomes more and more unfair, inappropriate, punishing, and so
mm-hmm.
on, and
mm-hmm.
it's not good.
Yeah.
So it's so important to be able to understand the kids and have some system of support for them so they don't get frustrated. Yeah,
right.
The older you get, the more frustrating it is to not be able to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We got a lot of people writing in on Facebook and on YouTube, so we're going to take a short break. We're going to come back and address some of the things you guys are writing in about. Stick with us.
Hello, fellow activists. In our last segment, we talked about step number 2, educate yourself. Step number 3 is get support. Now, any journey can feel overwhelming if you feel like you're walking it alone. Well, you're far from alone, because with 1 in 50 kids diagnosed with autism today, there are a lot of us out there. Of course, there's always the issue of financial support. Now, there's a handful of organizations out there that offer financial support to families in need. ACT Today, or Autism Care and Treatment Today, is one of them. Visit our website at www.act-today.org to find out more about our grant process. I want to talk about a different kind of support today, emotional support. Now, you can get that from other travelers on this path. Some of the best advice I've ever received is from the moms of other kids with autism who went to school with Wyatt or were involved with programs with him. Then there are the pioneers. These are the families that have gone through this years ago, and there was very little information out there. All of these people seem to have the desire to pay it forward. Now, one of them, Lisa Ackerman, who is one of my mentors, started an organization called TACA, talk about curing autism. She actually took the concept of mentors and support groups and made it available to everybody. You can go to their website, talkaboutcuringautism.org, to find out more. During the first and most difficult year after Wyatt's diagnosis, I wrote an email to close family and friends, letting them know what was going on and the challenges our family was facing and why we dropped out of sight. I was amazed at the outpouring of love and affection and all the help I received from that email. First, you have to be vulnerable. You can't be afraid to ask. Try this out. Could you cook me a meal? Are you going to the market? Can you pick me up a few things? Could your kids play with my kid and make them feel included? Or can you come over and clean my house? Well, maybe not that last one, except with your best friend. And maybe the best support of all is having someone that listens, and that doesn't cost a dime. So until next time, surround yourself with the loving kindness of others and keep the faith.
Welcome back to Autism Live and to Ask Dr. Doreen. We're here with Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh, and Nancy Allspot Jackson is here with
me.
Nice
to be here with you guys.
We're thrilled to be here answering your questions, having Dr. Granpeesheh answer your questions. We like to remind everybody that there is no expert that can give individual specific advice, but she's giving us great information, which is really wonderful. You guys have been writing in on YouTube, on Facebook. Right now, we want to take a question that came in on YouTube. Somebody wrote it in and said, my brother gets angry, and I don't know how to calm him. This kind of goes hand in hand with something that came in on our live feature. Hello, my 13-year-old is in a regular ed middle school and doing pretty good academically. He has some emotional outbursts, mostly with peers that like to push his buttons. How can we work on that at home? Also, when he breaks a house rule, he loses a privilege like video games, but he doesn't seem to care if anything gets taken away. It's like he doesn't value any of his things. I feel like we need a different consequence, but what? We cannot assume that the answer is the same for both of these, but they were kind of in the same category of, you know, people getting upset.
So
maybe you can talk to us a little bit about
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. I mean, and you know, we've talked about this quite a few times, but let me just approach it from a different angle. You know, if you tell me today that you are upset about something, I'm really upset. Let me tell you right now, Shannon, I'm really upset. What's the first thing you would say to me?
I would say, why? What's
going on? Exactly. Yeah. So the very most important thing is we need to find out why our kids are getting upset. It's not like they're just tantruming. It's not like, and it's, I know our initial reaction with our kids is to just calm them or soothe them, but you need to know why. That's the more important thing, because let's assume I say to you, blah, 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 and you're not going to know what it is. So what's your next step? You're going to try to calm me, right? You're going to say, oh, it's okay, it's okay. But the blah, 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 blah I was saying was that light is bothering me like crazy. And you did nothing about it. Okay. So just like our kids, what if something is bothering them? We don't know what it is. We try to do anything. We can try to calm them. We can try to soothe them. But it's not really taking care of the issue.
And oftentimes they won't say right away what it really is.
Because
that's what I find with my son.
That's the issue, of course, because they can't really put it together. Like some of the kids can't figure out what it is. Some of the kids have a hard time expressing what they just bothered them. Some of the kids can't really understand the question you just asked them. I mean, there's a lot of different reasons. And some of the kids have so much going on that they don't know which one is bothering them more. So it's really, really important to attach the child's unhappiness to some event that just caused this, right? So there's always going to be something that kind of tips them. So let's say, as an example with Wyatt, he might be on an ongoing thing, but you know,
I know it's something underneath that.
It's something, it's like, okay,
from experience, I know
he'll perseverate
on something else, and then I know there's something underneath that.
There's something underneath, and sometimes it's just there's okay, he's had enough. That's it. We've just now reached the tipping point. So, with the brother who is has a meltdown, or with this other child who has emotional outbursts, the very first thing you have to do is find out why. What we call that in ABA is a functional assessment. A functional assessment is a series of questions, and if we can't identify it through questions, then it's an experimental functional assessment where you actually do it through scenarios. But what your point is to figure out why that happened. What is the function? And what that means is, what's he actually trying to tell you? Because in having an emotional outburst, it's the same with us. It's exactly the same with us. If I suddenly start crying, the very first thing anyone's going to ask is, why are you crying? And because I have language, I can say, you know, I'm really sad, this happens, blah, blah, blah. And sometimes it's a very, very covert thing, right? I'm really sad because I remembered something. How on earth would a child with autism be able to express that, yeah, right? It's something that's internal and past. Like, it's just very hard. So it's important for us to try to figure out if the child is expressing sadness, if they're expressing anger. They could be saying, I'm just really mad at you. They could be saying, I'm just really irritated by that light. They could be saying, I just really wanted to get out of this classroom right now, mm-hmm, escape behavior. They mm-hmm could be saying, you know, I just really wanted your attention. There's a million things they could be saying. And the field of ABA has narrowed this down to very basic functions. Mm-hmm. It is always wanting something or avoiding something. Now, what are those some things that we want? It could be an object, a thing, a tangible, what we call. So an activity, an object, something, a food, whatever, something I want. Or it could be the avoidance of something I want, something I don't want. So for instance, you know, being in a classroom or having to do work or whatever it is, that's an escape or avoidance function. Or it could be an attention function. I just want to get attention on something. Or, by the way, I could do bad behavior too. I can hit you and I'll get mm-hmm your attention. Mm-hmm. So there's always a function to it. Once we find out what that is, then we know what happened. Then all you have to do is teach a better way for the child to express why. So why is the child, this one, having a meltdown when they're upset?
Don't just soothe them. Says mostly with peers that like to push
this button. This one says it can be, are you reading another one?
Peers that like to push buttons.
Okay, so with this child, the peers are, you know, probably making fun like that. So what do you think, why do you think he has the emotional outburst? If he had language, what would he say? If he had language, he would say, hey, you guys, leave me alone. That's mean, right? So how he's feeling inside is hurt, upset. So what do we have to do? We have to teach him, instead of having an emotional outburst, to actually say that language to mm-hmm the peers, get himself away from the peers, and go tell a teacher. Those would be the appropriate steps.
Yeah.
And if he's able to do that, you don't need to calm him. He will prevent, and the emotional outburst won't even happen because he now knows how to handle the peers.
What about the consequences that she asks about? That he breaks a house rule, he loses a privilege, like video games, but he doesn't seem to care.
So that's a different thing. We're going to talk about that in a minute. Okay. I just want to make sure that we address this other person's question as well.
Says the brother, my brother gets angry and I don't know how to calm him.
And that's the thing. You have to first, please don't calm him until you find out why he gets angry. That's really, really important, because if you continue to just calm the anger without knowing the cause, what you're doing is you're actually reinforcing the anger.
Yeah.
Like, in other words, for your brother, he figures out that the way to get, who doesn't like someone soothing them?
Right.
Who doesn't like someone calming them? Mm-hmm. We all do. That's a reinforcer. So he will figure out, whenever I'm frustrated, for whatever reason, the reason doesn't matter. As long as I have a tantrum, someone's going to come calm me.
Right.
So don't do that. Figure out first how you can give him enough communication to avoid the tantrum. That's much, much more important. Now, going back to the second portion of this question, which is a very interesting question, it says, when he breaks a house rule, he loses a privilege, like video games, and he seems like he doesn't care if you take anything away. It's like he doesn't value any of his things. Now, that's really interesting, because, if you had asked me this question, you know, 20, 30 years ago, I would have said, well, probably the things that you're taking away aren't of interest. That's not the case. Most of the times, the reason that our kids actually act like they don't care is because giving up control to you is a negative experience. So they pretend to not care because they realize that if they care, this is how smart our kids are. They realize that if they have a major reaction, you're going to know they care about that thing. And actually what they're doing is they just don't like being under the control of what you're doing, your manipulation. So he does care. It doesn't matter that he acts like he doesn't care. He cares. And as long as you're consequating it appropriately, which means you're taking away things only when he misused those things, then it's fine. You could keep doing that. It's a very interesting thing you learned. I'm sure you've seen that with Jim. It's kind of like, fine.
We have an expression.
Fine, take it away.
He's ABAing you. Teaching you, yes. That reinforcer isn't, it's not going to cost me anything, fine. So you won't threaten to take it away again.
Exactly.
It's very smart.
It is, and a lot of the kids do it, and I love it, and it's very much like, any other kid. Any other kid would be like, fine, take
exactly.
it away.
Yeah, you know, whatever. That's I don't care.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Oh, I love that. Absolutely love that. Okay, I want to turn to a really awesome question from our Facebook. How do you handle language and therapy if you adopt an ESL child on the spectrum? Do you need to get a therapy team who speaks your child's native language?
Mm-hmm.
Love this.
That is a fantastic question. I would say that really depends on, the age of the child primarily. So the first thing is, obviously, if they're living here, you want to be able to teach them English. They're going to have to be able to communicate in English. So that's your goal. The question is, if this is like a 6 or 7 year old who already has language and is able to communicate in a different language, then you need to find someone who can communicate in that other language and teach them English. If not, then you can just start with an English-speaking team. In other words, if the person is young, let's say 2 or 3, and they don't have another language yet developed, then you just go ahead and start teaching labels and everything else that we teach. I mean, our kids, for all practical purposes, when they start at 2 and 3, are nonverbal. It's as if they don't have another language, mm-hmm. and we teach them English.
Okay.
Whenever I've had a family who has been here and is planning to go back to another country, I tell them to get a team together with that language.
Okay.
It's really important because you teach them English, so what? They're going back to Saudi Arabia. You know, they're not going to be able to communicate in English.
Okay, but so just to be clear, if you have a 6 or 7 year old, though, that is already speaking at least a little bit in that other language,
right.
Make sure that you've got somebody on the team
with that
who
language.
Speaks both languages.
Because wouldn't you do that with any other child? Right?
Yes.
If it's a fluent French speaker at the age of 7 or 8, you're not just going
to
throw them in.
Yeah,
you're going
to
need
have to transition.
Someone who can help them
right.
translate French to English and
right.
English to French, right?
Right.
And if they don't have any French, though, if they're 2, you just throw them into English.
Okay, wonderful.
Language, by the way, develops between the age... The core period of language development in the brain is 4 to 7.
Yeah. Okay. Good to know.
People think language develops earlier.
Happy to hear that.
Yeah, so what develops earlier is joint attention. Yeah.
Okay.
Interesting. All right, we're going to take another short break, and then we're going to come back with a couple more questions and finish out this segment, Ask Dr. Doreen. But we'll have more Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy coming up after that, so stick with us. Welcome back to Autism Live and to Ask Dr. Doreen. We're here with Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh, and Nancy Allspaugh Jackson is here with me.
Love to sit in to hear a lot of this great advice.
Thrilled that you're here. Yeah. Want to say to those of you who are writing in on Facebook and saying you've just found us, welcome. We're thrilled that you're here. We are also on YouTube and on Roku and iTunes.
Very nice.
And free on all of those places, but we're new to Facebook Live. But we have lots of shows that you can see that we've recorded over the last 5 years. It's kind of amazing to think about. You can find all of those archived on YouTube and search by topics. But every Wednesday morning at this time, we're going to be here with Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh and interactive live, and you can ask questions, which is a wonderful thing. I want to go to a question that we also had come in on the Facebook Live. My 8-year-old, I got to press for more. I'm getting it on my phone. Let's see if I can make it work. Okay. My 8-year-old high-functioning son is very selective with food. He says he'll be eating when he grows up. Does it get easier as he gets older?
It's probably true, by the way. I've known kids who only eat white food until they're 18, right?
Well, I mean, if they have no intervention, but that's I just love how cute the kids are with how they explain things. My God, I'll eat when I'm older. That's just great. That means that's another way of just saying, get off my back.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's actually pretty important to work on food selectivity. I think we've done before a couple of lectures on Autism Live on expansion of the food selections. Yes. So a lot of the kids have selectivity. It varies. My theory about selectivity is the following. I think that it starts, it's kind of this, I always use the example of us as people so that parents understand what the child's going through. So let's say you go to, I don't know, a Mexican restaurant or something, and you eat something, and then you go home and you're sick. Or, you know what, a good example would be sushi. I just had this experience a few months ago, right? You go out and you have sushi and you are... you get sick that night, right? You throw up, you feel pretty bad. You feel bad, okay? You don't digest well. So what happens? If you go out and you have sushi,
you're kind of turned off to sushi for a while.
You're turned off to sushi. Are you turned off to anything else similar to sushi, like other fishes?
Things that smell like fish.
Things that smell like fish, perhaps. Okay, so with our kids, what happens is I think they go and they eat something and then they don't feel good. You know, as you know, many of our kids have GI issues and they have allergies and reactions to various foods. And more than anything else, they have bloating. They have they cannot digest various foods. So they have a reaction or some sort of physical experience that's not pleasant. Now, as a child, they may not yet classify the food. So they may not say, oh, that was a legume, and therefore I'm going to stay away from all other legumes, right? As a child, more likely they're going to say, I'm going to stay away from every food that's green. Mm-hmm. Because I ate, like, I'm just nothing that looks like that. Or nothing that... has the sensation of that. So like all mushy foods or all crunchy foods or whatever it is, right? Mm-hmm. Because they're a child. That's how they classify. They're not classifying according to nutritional guidelines like we do. So then that's generalization. That's very natural generalization, right? So they've been punished by one stimulus naturally, and now that grows. It generalizes to other stimuli that are similar to that. So they will now stay away from all that class. It is important to change that for two reasons. One is that nutritionally, it becomes dangerous. There are some, like the other child that we talked about, sometimes it just becomes a concern because the child's not eating anything, or it becomes broader and broader. I mean, I have had children who wouldn't eat anything except for really perfectly shaped Cheerios because their obsession was the shape of the food, the perfection aspect of the food. So that's, of course, dangerous for a growing child. And the other reason is that you never really want to allow the child to do anything that would be, that would in any way reduce their ability to participate in social activities. Mm-hmm. So unless the child actually has valid allergies and should stay away, a lot of times our kids avoid, let's say, milk because it makes them feel bad. Great. They should avoid milk. It's not good for most of our kids. So those types of things are perfectly fine, but if they're avoiding it and it's generalizing to more than just the things that they are allergic to or react to, then it's important to reverse that. Reversing that is a very easy behavioral process.
Do they need to work with an ABA therapist to introduce new foods gradually?
Exactly. There's two groups that do this. ABA people do this and speech paths do this. And so all you have to do is really work on the reintroduction of feeding, broadening your food array. Most of the time, it's just a shaping procedure. It is very fun. It's easy. We have a lot of training videos on this, I think, that you might have. It's very easy. You just start with increasing morsels of food, increasing texture, increasing the amount and different varieties, and it's a process where you're just reinforcing, so it's fun.
It is very common for a lot of our kids on the spectrum to crave just the carbohydrates in the dairy, correct?
That's a whole different issue.
It
is a big issue, though. You're completely right. It is a big problem because the child tends to, all of us, we crave the things that we are allergic to or cause our body to have an allergic reaction or a reaction to. That's why we all crave sugar. That's why we all crave various things like carbs. Mm-hmm. Carbs have a different effect as well. Carbs will generally slow you down and make your mind a little bit fuzzy, which we all crave. But so those types of things, of course, that's the reason. But then with our kids, it tends to like generalize into this huge out of control thing where pickiness develops, and it's a big deal. It is a big deal.
Parents ask us a lot of questions about diet and things because there are a lot of diets that are out there for autism, but a lot of times the story is, I would do the gluten-free, casein-free diet. I would try it, but I can't because my child wouldn't eat anything because my child lives on nuggets and milk macaroni and cheese. And the bad news that I always say to parents is, if that's all your child is eating, it's very likely that you're one of the people that a gluten-free, casein-free diet would be an amazing thing for you.
It would be amazing. And that's good news because once you actually overcome that huge mountain, the child reacts so positively. Right. But I'll say it's not just in this field. Like, you have to realize this is all kids. Like, my son had a phase where he would only drink milk when he was two. And nothing else. Like, he would literally not eat. Mm-hmm. And I realized one day, oh my God, he's not eating anything and he's like drinking a lot of milk. I cut out the milk instantly. Yeah. And of course, he went like a couple of days of just, being upset and tantruming and all that. And then he was like, I gotta eat something, And then his diet just broadened and he went from this like skinny, tiny little thing to growing really fast.
Yeah.
And it's very, very important. And it won't happen. The broadening won't happen if you're just consuming high amounts of the thing you're not supposed to take.
Yeah. Well, and also nowadays, the way, the food industry has changed so much that you can go get gluten-free nuggets and you can get dairy-free, gluten-free macaroni and cheese at a regular grocery store.
That you can get out there is delicious.
Crazy. You guys remember? Yeah.
It was awful. No self-respecting mouse would eat that cheese.
Exactly. Cheese or anything, you guys. I mean, like, I go to, now my daughter, Charlie, is very interested in, like, going gluten-free, and I take her to Whole Foods, and I'm just looking at Whole Foods, and I'm thinking to myself, my God. Mm-hmm. Just 10 years ago or 15 years ago, like, there was nothing.
It was so difficult.
Nothing.
You had to do mail order.
Honestly.
It came and it was an asbestos tile and tasted like it.
It was horrible.
And it cost
$300.
$300.
Right. Yes.
Yeah.
There was maybe one cookie that Whole Foods had that was, like, gluten-free. And I used to get massive boxes and mail it to South Africa. Like, it's just we had nothing, and there's so many resources now here in the States. It's ridiculous,
and that tastes good. We had a cheesecake over the holidays that even my husband said,
"Really?
Are you kidding me? This is dairy free, gluten free."
Wow, isn't that amazing?
It was crazy.
Sounds delicious.
Yeah.
I'm
hungry
now.
It was pretty good.
Yep.
All right, now we've awakened the monster in all of us. Okay, we only have 3 minutes.
Okay.
You think we want to do a question? I really want to go to this one. We saw a doc for 2 years in Boston and refused to diagnose my son with ASD when all the other doctor's friends, especially myself, raising at him, know he has all the symptoms. I don't need his diagnosis, but it bothered me so much that my son couldn't communicate for himself and the doctor saw no autism. We're seeing more and more of this. We thought we were past it with the whole PDD-NOS going away. We're not.
That's amazing.
Any advice for these families that aren't getting the diagnosis?
Yeah, I mean, I just don't know why you wouldn't be, or I don't know what is the motivation. I know that it's still a pretty scary thing for pediatricians. There are some young pediatricians who feel they just don't have the expertise. Mm-hmm. But I really don't know why they would not be diagnosing. It's very straightforward and simple. I mean, go online, look at Autism Speaks website. I think our website even has it. There's a series of symptoms. If your child has... Mm-hmm. a certain number of each category of symptom, it's the diagnosis. It's a very simple process.
I just really, my question is, we're seeing a lot of these coming from HMOs, and I really believe that they're being told don't hand out diagnoses because it's going to cost us. Really believe that that's what's driving it, and I think shame on those doctors if that is what's happening.
Well, that's I'm here to be the proof that I had a doctor who poo-pooed me for a year.
Yeah.
And then finally at age three said, well, I don't know what he's got, but he's at least a year delayed.
You know, I have to say, Nancy, back then, like maybe 10 years ago or 15 years ago, there was less, before Autism Speaks, right?
Yes.
There was much less information.
Right.
The primary reason was doctors did not recognize it. Now, that's not a good excuse anymore.
Right,
it's like,
right.
come on. You know, everyone knows someone with autism. This family, if you really are certain about this, I would go to another doctor, get the diagnosis. You need the diagnosis for insurance. Shannon is right. That's very important. And I would probably report that doctor to the board.
Yeah.
Like, there's just, it's unethical for doctors to do whatever it is they're doing if it is for the purposes of an insurance company or someone else telling them what to do. That's just hugely unethical. So, you know, I would just move on. It's sad. It's unfortunate.
But I, you know, I always want to celebrate the gut instinct of the parent that,
for
you know,
sure.
How many times have we had parents who've said they've gone to the doctor and didn't feel like it was right? Keep chasing it. Keep chasing it. And do get that diagnosis so you can get the treatment.
Definitely.
You get
for
the
sure.
Definitely.
I mean, and, you know, I want to say doctors only have often like 15 minutes, maybe 30 minutes.
Yeah.
They
right.
don't spend enough
that's
time.
Exactly. That's one of the biggest issues is they don't, in that well baby checkup.
That's right.
You know, at whatever the ages you get them, they don't have the time to see it.
They don't, and that's not their fault. No. Insurance companies control them.
Right.
Yeah. But we have to drive the bus. So
absolutely.
We thank you so much for
everything
that you shared.
It was such a pleasure.
It was great to be with you today.
Nice to see you.